Good morning and welcome. Good morning and welcome to our last day of Cybus. Fourth and last day. Believe me, for me, it feels like I've been here for nearly a month. I'm particularly excited by this Cybus. At the same time, I have to tell you that I'm completely exhausted as well. So my name is Alain Haas. I'm chief executive at Swift for EMEA, Europe, Middle East and Africa, and Asia Pacific. And I'm actually living in Singapore. And that tells you a bit more about how we at Swift, we're taking the importance of Asia, especially ASEAN. We're looking now at Europe from Asia. That tells you also the new approach that we do have. So welcome to this session. So the themes of ASEAN financial integrations is clearly contemporary and relevant, as we believe ASEAN approaches an important milestone this year, which is the realization of the vision to establish the ASEAN economic community. So let's put this a bit in perspective. Here we're talking about a region of about 625 million inhabitants. This is about 9% of the worldwide population. This is more than the whole of the European community. This is more than America, the US, and Canada altogether. This is the third labor force in the world. That tells you exactly what we're talking about here. But we also know at the same time that the path to economic integrations is inherently not a bed of roses, given that political and economic imperatives do not always converge altogether. And I guess that the example of my home country, Belgium, with the Benelux, can certainly tell you a bit more about it, and certainly also the examples of the European community. But at the same time, having been living there for many years, at the same time, we all know that there are enormous opportunities that can be realized for the good of the member countries. For regions as diverse as ASEAN, where political systems, cultural backgrounds, stage of economic developments, and domestic priorities vary widely, the challenges are substantially greater, but not impossible to overcome with unity, communication, and collaborations. And as I told you, I've been in Europe for, you know, certainly the last 35 years, and this is exactly also what happened over there. What impressed me about the ASEAN economic blueprint is that actually it was adopted in November 2007 by ASEAN leaders when the global financial crisis was upon all of us. It was at the time a courageous and visionary decision. The unfolding of the crisis, including the issues faced by the European financial and economic integration process, provide important lessons for ASEAN as we advance our own integration journey. Speaking about lessons learned, we also know that ASEAN cannot just take the integration model of Europe or Africa as their initiative there and just copy-paste it. That wouldn't work. At the same time, I have to say that there are similarities and certainly lessons that everybody can learn from each other. And perhaps a good example I'd like to mention here is the one that really comes to my mind is the Lisbon Treaty in Europe that has been signed by all the European countries about the early 2000s. And this treaty had an objective to build together all the European countries infrastructures of all nature. And it could be trains, roads, you know, electricity grids, and also market infrastructures that ultimately will make the European landscape and land as efficient for the business as the US economy is. When it comes to the financial industry, this overarching treaty led to the creations of many market infrastructures, financial market infrastructures, things like SEPA initiatives, the T2S, new market infrastructures, and many other financial treaties that ultimately leverage the power of a single currency and make ultimately also the market a lot safer. So it's clearly, perhaps not the single currency, but it's clearly there are lessons to be learned from that treaty as well. Although with us a single currency objective in mind, I know that some other similar experiences are currently under development in regions like Africa. I'm sure that you've heard about initiatives like SADC, WAMSI in the western part of Africa. You've heard about the Eastern African countries' initiatives as well. When it comes to SADC, for instance, there's already initiatives about market infrastructures putting together payment systems that will cover all countries of this part of the world. Looking back at ASEAN, I'm of the view that progress is making way and that the size and potential of these regions will continue to serve many of us well. SWIFT, in our side, is working very closely with the key stakeholders in the region, sharing our experience and market best practices. Earlier this month, we have distributed our response to the effort of the Cross-Border Settlement Infrastructures Forum, CSIF, to establish cross-border DVP linkage between CSDs and ITGS in ASEAN plus three countries. This information paper shares our views on how SWIFT and its community is well positioned to assist participating market infrastructures in an operational and cost-efficient manner to progress with the establishment of a regional settlement infrastructures. On the payment side, we are also actively discussing with WCPSS, central bank governors, and the ASEAN Banking Association the possibility of establishing an ASEAN Payment Council and payment schemes similar to what the European Community has done with the EPC and SEPA at a time. This paper, we've just actually published a paper on this subject, and this paper and our response to CSIF are both available for you to pick up at the back of this room. So voilà, this is really the remarks I'd like to make at the beginning of these sessions. We are actually very much fortunate to have all of you here today. We're also very much fortunate to have very prestigious speakers for this session. So I'd like to wish you a very fruitful ASEAN Day. This is very at the heart of what all of us are doing in Asia. And I'm certainly looking forward to seeing you all throughout the day. Thank you very much. And I leave now the stage to Eddie Haddad. Thank you.
Thanks, Alain. Good morning, everybody. My name is Eddie Haddad. I look after all of our client relationships across six sub-regions in Singapore, in APAC, rather, at SWIFT. Excuse me. When we were planning Cybos this year, you can imagine the planning starts a lot earlier, we said we must have something around ASEAN. So today, this whole day, there's a stream of sessions specifically on ASEAN. And you heard what Alain said about some of the papers and our engagement with ASEAN. You know, the time is now for ASEAN. You'll see SWIFT stepping up a lot more and engaging a lot more and doing our bit to help the process of ASEAN integration, particularly around market infrastructures and connectivity of those market infrastructures. This morning gives me great pleasure to introduce two of our leading banks here in Singapore. First of all, Mr. Wee E. Chong, Deputy Chairman and CEO of UOB, will get up and make some remarks. Mr. Wee E. Chong joined UOB in 1979 and served as Deputy Chairman and President of the bank from 2000 to 2007. On 27th of April 2007, he was appointed as Chief Executive Officer, non-independent and Executive Director. He's a member of the Executive and Board Risk Management Committees. He's a career banker with more than 30 years experience. Mr. Wee holds directorships in several of UOB subsidiaries. Mr. Wee is also Chairman of the Association of Banks in Singapore and serves as Director of the Institute of Banking and Finance and Chairman of the IBF Standards Committee. He was awarded the Public Service Star for contributions to the financial services industry. Please welcome Mr. Wee. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Eddie, for your fine remark. Good morning, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Good to see all of you. And I hope your time at Cybos and in Singapore has been fruitful so far. Having this conference in Singapore is timely. not just because Singapore is celebrating 50 years of nationhood this year, but in particular, given today's focus on ASEAN. Singapore, as one of the five founding members of ASEAN back in 1967, has been playing a strategic role in this development. Today, Singapore remains a firm advocate of and a key gateway to ASEAN. As a global and regional financial hub, we are honored to be hosting SIBOS this year. On behalf of Singapore banks, a very warm welcome to every one of you here. When we think of ASEAN, what typically comes to mind? By its very name, it is an association which aims to promote the region's economic growth, social progress, and cultural development, while ensuring peace and security in the region. ASEAN now has a membership of 10 Southeast Asian countries, and since its founding, has also grown in terms of economic prosperity and international profile. As a regional bloc, while expressed intentions are noble, it hasn't always received good press. Member countries seek to cooperate while abiding by the principle of non-interference, which some may read as ineffective and toothless. Secondly, ASEAN has a vision to be an economic community starting from the end of this year. The ASEAN Economic Community, or AEC, aims to transform the region into a single market and production base with freer movement of goods, services, investments, and skilled labor across countries. The vision for an integrated ASEAN is a compelling one, and there are great expectations for the AEC too. Taken individually, most ASEAN countries are too small to be effective globally. Taken as a whole, their collective strength is far greater than some of its parts. But the journey towards creating a freer and more harmonious market is not a smooth one. The ambitious goals require more concerted efforts and the will to turn it into action on the ground. And progress can be faster. The experience of other regional blocs, such as recent troubles faced by the EU, also provides lessons to be learned. The reality is this: ASEAN is a diverse region with countries at different stages of development, different political systems and national priorities, multiple cultures and languages. Yet this diversity is also a strength. In recent months, ASEAN has also been associated with emerging market capital outflows. Globally, we operate in an increasingly volatile environment with slowing growth and shifting geopolitical dynamics. Current turmoil in various countries adds to the uncertainties as the world adjusts to a new equilibrium. ASEAN is not spared. There are concerns about a repeat of the 1997 Asian financial crisis. This is because the current situation bears some resemblance to the conditions then, when the Federal Reserve started to raise interest rates. Oil prices were depressed, and emerging market currencies were devalued. Indeed, worrying if you compare the similarities. But there are key differences. Asia and ASEAN's fundamentals are a lot sounder, and their economies stronger than before. In fact, the depreciation in ASEAN currency acts as a timely shock absorber for ASEAN's external economy. This is in stark contrast to the situation in 1997, when many ASEAN economies had their currency pegged to the US dollar, and the subsequent heavy borrowing in US dollar and growing trade deficits make the currency pegs unsustainable. Today, Asia clearly does not have the structural issue of 1998. While there are some concerns about consumer leverage, policymakers are responding proactively. From the standpoint of current account balances, foreign reserves, external debt, or corporate leverage, the risks in Asia today are a lot more manageable. Overall, we remain confident of the region's prospects. As an economic bloc, ASEAN is now the seventh largest country in the world and is expected to be the fourth largest by 2030. We all know ASEAN is strategically positioned in terms of geography and demographics. Geographically, ASEAN proximity to major markets such as China and India reinforces its strategic role in the global value chain. Emerging markets, such as those in the Mekong Basin, are viewed as new frontiers with untapped potential. Demographics-wise, ASEAN populations of 630 million is young, driven, and enterprising. Its growing middle class and urbanization will not only drive domestic economic demand, but spur intra-regional trade and investment flows. To cite some figures, in just 5 years, intra-ASEAN trade had almost doubled from US $332 billion to reach US $600 billion. By our estimates, this will hit the US $1 trillion mark in 2020. Investors are keen on the ASEAN story and have been bringing in significant amounts of investments into this region. Foreign direct investment flow into ASEAN almost tripled from 2009 to 2013, from US $47 billion to US $125 billion. And surplus FDI flows into China for the first time in 2013. Not surprisingly, the UN Conference on Trade and Development reported that ASEAN has overtaken China as the most attractive destination for FDI. In short, ASEAN is an attractive market for investors looking to fulfill the demand for products, services, and infrastructure in the region. But ASEAN's potential extends beyond that. Structural trends are reinforcing ASEAN's role in the global arena. With economic and regulatory changes, Banking models are graduating from the west to the east. Increasing connectivity and geopolitical dynamics are integrating markets, whether physical or digitally. Amid the conflicting forces of global interdependence and economic nationalism, their move to strengthen linkages among countries. Last Monday, we witnessed the landmark agreement on the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP, among 12 member economies, accounting for about 40% of world GDP and a quarter of world trade. There are four ASEAN members in the TPP: Singapore, Brunei, Malaysia, and Vietnam, with more countries waiting to join the pact. Details are still being worked out, but we see opportunities, including how AEC and TPP can potentially work together to enhance trade and investment flows. Beyond the AEC and TPP, there is China's One Belt, One Road, and infrastructure connectivity initiatives. Indeed, infrastructure development in Asia is nothing short of massive. The 21st century maritime Silk Road connecting China with Southeast Asia, or the 80,000 kilometer Trans-Asian Railway, are just two examples of large-scale infrastructure projects connecting ASEAN to new opportunities. The economic benefits from these projects will be enormous and will help strengthen ASEAN's role in the global manufacturing and supply chain. The ongoing internationalization of renminbi will also help strengthen linkages between ASEAN and its key trading partners. There will be a panel discussion on this subject today. At the same time, technology is redefining traditional boundaries and cross-border constraints. Digital trends are transforming industries and business models at a pace and manner not seen before. In our interconnected world, ASEAN potential extends beyond that of a regional association, integrated market, or production base. It is a strategic hub, and its role can be pivotal. Let me give an example of, now I represent UOB, of how UOB approach it. From a small bank in Singapore 80 years ago, we now have more than 500 branches across Asia, including our latest branch in Myanmar. We have the largest Southeast Asia network among Singapore banks. We have had a head start in tapping cross-border flow. We saw the trend a few years ago and persevere in building an integrated regional platform to service customers seamlessly across the region. We also set up FDI advisory units 4 years ago to support cross-border flows within and into ASEAN from other parts of the world. We tied up with government agencies, industry bodies, and other ecosystem partners to provide one-stop solutions to clients as they expand regionally. We now have FDI teams across 9 countries: Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia, China, Hong Kong, Vietnam, Myanmar, and India. Progress has been encouraging. We see more and more companies requiring such services. We are also partnering financial institutions and industry players to facilitate their clients' expansion into the region. The connectivity and ecosystem benefits have helped close to 600 companies expand regionally. Our long-term commitment to clients, deep local understanding, and ability to support cross-border flows were recognized at the ASEAN Business Awards in 2014, where we were named the most admired ASEAN enterprise for ASEAN centricity. We will continue to invest in our network and capabilities to support clients and partners' growth in the long run. In fact, a few months ago, we collaborated with strategic partners to host the first ASEAN conference in Singapore for policymakers and clients. The conference grew a lot of interest from the business community, and it mirrors our excitement for the region. With the economic struggles in the West and China's self-engineered slowdown, the world is looking for the next global engine of growth. It could well be at our doorstep, but it requires cooperations and collaborations across countries and cultures, corporates, banks, and regulators working together to realize the potential for all. We hope today's conference will deepen your understanding and broaden your perspectives about the potential of ASEAN. We have distinguished speakers and panelists to share their thoughts on development in key areas and how industry players can effectively seize opportunities in a fast-evolving landscape. Given the diverse markets and complexities in ASEAN, working with a trusted partner with the regional knowledge, connectivity, and track record will be key to success. UOB is well placed in this regard, and we look forward to partner every one of you in growing your ASEAN franchise. On this note, I wish you all of you here have an insightful session and fruitful journey within ASEAN, and have a safe trip home. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Yi Chong. The next part of the program this morning will actually be an interview. So could I please welcome Mr. Samuel Sian, Chief Executive Officer of OCBC, to the stage. Interviewing him will be Sri Jagaraga from CNBC. Please join us. Samuel Sian was appointed Group Chief Executive Officer on 15th of April 2012. He joined OCBC Bank in July 2007 and as Senior Executive Vice President, managing the group's corporate and commercial banking business. In 2008, he assumed the position as Global Head of Global Corporate Bank and added responsibilities of overseeing the financial institution and transaction banking business. He has 36 years of banking experience. Samuel was also a director of Maple Tree Commercial Trust and holds a Bachelor of Arts with honours in economics from UCLA. Thank you and welcome. Over to you, Sri.
Thank you very much, Eddie. Samuel, thank you very much for this opportunity as well. Let me start off by just going back in time. Back to 1932, when OCBC was founded. You have a very solid foundation in Singapore. You're one of the oldest local banks here, When you look back on your near 90-year history, what would you say are the major milestones? Because you must have seen at least four or five economic cycles during the bank's history, highlights and lowlights. Talk us through the milestones in OCBC's history.
Sure. First of all, good morning to all of you, and it's good to be here. Good to talk to you, Sri. You're right, OCBC was formed in 1932, but as a matter of fact, one of our predecessor banks was actually formed in 1912. So in that sense, if we include the predecessor bank, we are over 100 years. And over the past 100 years, we have gradually built up our franchise around the world, particularly in Southeast Asia. We have ride through many economic cycles, but I think the most important thing we always bear in mind is that we really have the customer's interest in mind. And we also have to hone in on our competitive advantages. It is not possible for a bank to be competing with every bank. We have to make sure that we have a competitive advantage that we can hone on. And I think for OCBC Bank, when we were first formed in Singapore, we made use of our customer franchise then. We follow our customers to go overseas, and we gradually expand our franchise that way. It is not that we decided to go to a country and then we build up a franchise there. We follow our customers there, build up strength there, follow our customers, go to other countries, and build up a strength there. Focus is very important. Focusing on the customer franchise is very important. And don't just plant the flag anywhere.
What would you say was the most toughest period in your history, commercially and economically speaking?
Well, in the recent history, the Asian financial crisis would be the most tough time for the banks here in Asia, because not only are we having internal weaknesses, which I think internal weaknesses are caused by excesses that we have incurred ourselves, but on the other hand, there are also external forces played in our home markets, which aggravated the problems, which make it much more difficult for us to handle.
And Mr. Wee touched on this in his speech. Do you fear that we're going to see a rerun of 1997 again in ASEAN?
Unlikely. I think the fundamentals of ASEAN countries, and for that matter, Asian countries, whether it includes Korea in it as well, is now very different. The cooperation between the central banks are also very different then. So from both a preparedness perspective by the governments, such as the reserves that we have, the preparedness of the intergovernmental agreements, such as the swap agreements that we now have with many of the countries, plus the fundamental wealth that people in these countries have accumulated are very different from 1997. So I don't think there will be a repeat of the crisis of 1997, but it doesn't mean that we are now in a more challenging situation than a few years ago.
Malaysia and Indonesia, though, specifically, are in something of a perfect storm right now. There's a terms of trade shock from the collapse in commodities and the revenue generated there for public balances. There's currency devaluation from China, competitive devaluation in the region. And on top of that, the politics are very challenging as well. And then you have the China slowdown and the imminent Fed rate hike and a higher rates environment, capital outflows too. Isn't there a number of different issues that are converging at a very difficult time for Malaysia and Indonesia in particular?
Well, you cited many market events that's happening, but if you look at any period, there were always market events that's happening. There was never a period of time that all of the things are happening very favorably to all countries. So if you look at Asia now, we talk a lot about China, and we talk about the slowdown of China. I look at it a little bit differently from most of the commentaries. I think we focus on China's slow growth by looking at its GDP growth being lower than it was before. And 2008, it was somewhere around 12-14%, and now it's somewhere around 6-7%. And we all fear that it is heading to a slowdown. But for China, 6-7% growth is still double the GDP growth of the world on average. And secondly, for China, they focus quite a bit on employment creation. Last year, in 2014, when the growth was down to 7.2%, the number of new jobs that was created was 13 million. In 2007, when the economic growth was somewhere around 12 to 14%, it was only 11 million. And for China, the most important thing from an economic policy perspective is not so much to maintain the GDP growth, but to maintain social stability in the form of job creation. So in that manner, I can still view China's economy as very stable and progressing at a slower speed than before, but they are doing a lot of structural things internally, such as to create domestic consumption instead of export orientation, to drive up economic activities for the country. Coming back to your question of Malaysia and Indonesia, I think Malaysia and Indonesia have got additional internal issues to address. But still, the fundamentals of these countries continues to be there. They have the local domestic consumption. They have a much more appropriate policy in place in terms of addressing the economic situations domestically. And then they have to face with the reducing export prices, which affects the fiscal deficit issue. But still, the fundamentals are still there. For them, we believe to be able to ride it out. It will be more challenging times than a few years ago, but right now we still think that they have the ability to ride out those storms.
Quick response, Samuel, on China. Is there a risk of a hard landing there?
I do not think so. I think there is a long landing instead of a hard landing.
And does the PBOC and the leadership in Beijing need to do more in terms of policy support? And we're talking about more focused, more decisive monetary policy. I'm talking about fiscal support and a weaker currency as well. All of the above. Because the sense that I'm getting is that we are seeing a misallocation of capital with the current stimulus program, and we need to see bolder, decisive action, almost a Draghi-like moment for the PBOC and the leadership in China. Do we need to see that?
I believe the PBOC will take more proactive actions and more concrete actions. But we have to recognize that PBOC is in the situation that no Western economies have. They have three tools that nobody have altogether. Some have some, but not all. They have the tools itself, they have the channels, and they have the knowledge.
I know
all these three tools combined is very effective for a centrally planned economy to ride out economic storms. It doesn't mean that they are able to address the fundamental problems immediately, but at least, as I said, it is likely that they will be able to avoid a hard landing, but there will still be a long landing because there were excesses that were created in the past of which they now have to absorb. And these excesses will take a long time for them to absorb. But in a normal economy, they will address it through a quick restructuring so that you have a short pain. But you have to recognize that for China, in order to maintain social stability, which is their prime objective, they will rather like to have a longer time to resolve these issues. But in the meantime, through administrative measures, through fiscal measures, through monetary measures, to address those issues as they come.
We've been jumping around all over the place and all over the region, so let's just bring it back to Singapore and your business. And you have endured at OCBC, and you've grown through tough times. Do you put that down to strategic vision, your people, the culture, the mindset at OCBC? What's driven OCBC through the cycles here?
We are very focused. We don't diversify into activities for diversification purposes. So for OCBC, there are three core areas that we focus on: commercial banking, wealth management, and insurance. So we're very focused. In terms of countries, we build up our presence gradually, but right now our focus countries will be Singapore, Malaysia, Indonesia, and Greater China. We are in 18 countries and regions around the world. The other countries at the current time are supporting our customers as they go outside of Singapore, Malaysia, Indonesia, and Greater China. We do not do as much business in the other countries other than these four. It doesn't mean that we will stop at these four, but we will gradually build. So as we have, we just built up, as many of you know, a stronger presence in Greater China through the acquisition of Wing Hang Bank. So we will make sure that our foothold in the Greater China region is going to be both deepening and widening. Once we've completed that, then we'll look at other opportunities. So being focused has been something that OCBC has really concentrated on, and I think it has served us well.
Let's talk about the competitive landscape, Samuel. Mm. Fintech, big thematic talking point at this CyBOS summit. Is it a challenge or is it an opportunity for banks like OCBC?
We need to work with fintech companies. I think fintech companies have got many solutions that the banks can rely on. We do not need to treat them as a threat. I think it's quite complementary. And I do not think that fintech will entirely disrupt the financial industry. However, it will prompt the financial industry to move faster, particularly in the area of employing technology for client servicing, for payment services, for processing.
And there's a sense in the traditional banking space that if you can't beat fintech, you just buy them. Is there scope for digital M&A at OCBC? Is that a strategy that you're considering adopting to assimilate these companies into your broader collective?
Not necessarily in terms of buying companies, but buying technology, certainly yes.
Do you think that the regulatory landscape over here and in Europe and the States, where fintech is really taking off, is keeping up with this disruptive technology in financial services?
When we talk about fintech, we sort of group them together. I look at fintech, there are two streams. One stream is actually very complementary to banking in the sense that we can make use of the things that they have created and make use of it in the banking arena. Those are the processing technologies, maybe the blockchain technology, maybe the API architecture that we can make use of. Another type of fintech companies are the P2P lending, crowd lending side. It seemed to me that those are the areas of which the commercial banks have chosen not to go into because of the cost structure, and also because the way that the commercial banks have in the past reached the audience is different from what these fintech companies have tried to. I think that's an area that the banks can learn from. But on the other hand, I also think that the fintech companies in that category are currently playing what I would call a regulatory arbitrage, because they are currently not as stringently regulated as the banks, and therefore there is a bit more room for them to play. At the end of the day, I believe that those fintech companies...
So what you're saying, Samuel, is that there isn't a level playing field at the moment in terms of the regulation?
For those sectors, such as P2P lending and crowdfunding, I think they are playing in a different plateau. And over time, if they were to be an institution who will handle what I would call public money, meaning that the depositors put money with you because of the trust they have in the financial system, they will be regulated as the banks should be regulated.
When you look around at fintech and these young upstarts, if you will, who do you think is the most disruptive? Who do you feel is doing the most, developing the most exciting and innovative way? And who poses the biggest challenge? Is there one company out there who you're constantly looking over your shoulder at?
Now, first of all, I actually try to avoid using the word disruptive because I think that's antagonistic. The former category, which is the category that created technology and architectures of which the bank can use, I think those are really the companies that we will work with going forward. As I said, the blockchain, the API architecture. There is a lot of opportunities for the bank to delve into and for the bank to make use of in order to extend a more efficient service to the market. I think these companies will be survivors and will actually help the banking industry to transform, to become more efficient and more interactive with our customers.
So just to bookend this conversation, it's very much parallels what's been happening with Bitcoin. So you would argue that the death of the banking system, the traditional model of the banking system, has been greatly exaggerated.
I believe that it has been overstated. The element of truth in the fintech companies being having a value is more helping the banking industry to transform rather than using the word disruptive.
All right. Let's move on to ASEAN and economic integration. How significant is this for OCBC, and what's the bank been doing to capitalize on the momentum?
It is helpful to further expand the banking market for OCBC. Having said that, I think we must all acknowledge that in terms of one ASEAN, perhaps the trade integration is more advanced than the banking integration. The banking integration is still at the stage where the most that we can now say is that we do encourage two countries to work together and strike a bilateral agreement such that they will be able to reach into each other's markets in a freer way. We are not yet able to say all the 10 ASEAN countries are already at a stage where each of the 10 countries can then go into each other's territories without any control.
And basically because the economies are at different stages of development,
that is absolutely
we need
right.
to see convergence.
Because of the different maturity of our market as well as our financial market, I think it is a bit too advanced, too premature for us to talk about one ASEAN. So for two countries to work together, and then you've got other countries work together, I think in the future we'll create a network of countries gradually opening up to countries of their own maturity.
So ultimately, an ASEAN economic community is a multi-year story or a multi-decade story?
It is likely that we will take probably half a generation. One generation is about 30 years, so half a generation, maybe 10, 15 years, before the one ASEAN concept can be adopted as they were originally proposed.
And a single ASEAN currency along the same time frame?
I am not sure that needs to be there. If you have one single currency, you basically take away the monetary policy of each individual countries. And each individual countries being differently driven, I am not sure that one ASEAN currency is really the way that we should go.
Okay, let's turn it towards trade, Samuel. Mr. Wee was talking about the TPP. Let's get your take on it. It stands to benefit several ASEAN nations, Vietnam and Philippines in particular. What does it mean in terms of the trade finance business at OCBC? Surely there must be some benefits and some low-hanging fruit for you.
Well, in the event that all of the details are announced and people know how to operate under the new TPP arrangement, I think the bilateral trade between those countries which have signed on the TPP will be able to increase, and we'll be able to tag onto that and do more businesses.
Okay. Let's turn it our focus towards the global economy and the proverbial gorilla in the living room, which is the US Federal Reserve and the imminent rate hike. What's going to be the impact on NIMS, net interest margins, the impact on SIBOR, and the implications for household debt serviceability, not only in Singapore, but ASEAN as a whole?
If I may just address the first part of your question with respect to the impact on NIM. Everything being equal, the NIM will rise. But not everything will be equal, because the customer's behavior in a high interest rate environment will be different from in a low interest rate environment. People who are now putting a lot of money into current account, into savings account, because the interest rate is just so low, may just decide not to do it because the interest rate is so low. Once the interest rate rise, they will have a different behavior. So the funding cost is likely to increase. That's why I say everything being equal, it's going to be very significantly beneficial to the bank's NIM. But in the reality, I think it will still be helpful, but it will not be as big as everything being equal. With respect to the impact on the economies, I think Singapore stress under a high interest rate environment will be something quite manageable. Because the leveraged positions, generally speaking, for Singapore companies and Singapore individuals has not been extreme. There probably will be a few sectors which are a bit more stressed because of external factors happening at the same time. For example, companies in the oil and gas industry will be hit on both ends, interest rate as well as their export revenue, their sales revenue will be coming down. But by and large, I think Singapore will be able to manage that situation quite well. Some of the other Asian countries may be a bit more stressful if their household debt is higher than that of Singapore.
What's your base case reckoning on when the Fed could undertake the first rate hike? Is there one at OCBC?
Sorry?
Is there a, do you have a base case scenario as to when the Fed will undertake the first rate hike?
We believe that the Fed will probably wait until the very last moment to decide whether they're going to raise it or not, but looking at the latest economic situation. So at the present time, I think directionally, they really wanted to raise the rate one time before the end of the year. But I think because of the latest economic indicators, they may have to reconsider. So it's a decision that whether you make it before the end of the year or you make it sometime in the first quarter of next year, to me, it doesn't really matter. Directionally, the world is ready for an interest rate rise.
China's currency. The share in global currency transactions as measured by SWIFT is around 2.8% according to data that SWIFT released earlier on this month. So it's edged out the Japanese yen.
Yes.
It's moving forward in terms of currency liberalization in China. And do you see that share rising of global currency payments?
I do. I think the renminbi really wanted to have the qualifications to become an international currency. And it started off by focusing on trade. It gradually moved on to payments, meaning including trade and non-trade. And I think it will gradually move on to be a savings currency. A difference between a trade and payment versus savings is trade and payment typically have one leg in China. They do it because there is one leg in China. I think it also has a desire to become a savings currency, or some people call it the reserve currency, where you do not really have a leg in China, but you want to hold on to that currency because you wanted to treat it as a currency that you can use for future use, but not necessarily directly related to China. And I think that directionally, that's the way to go. If that direction is correct, I think China's currency being used internationally will continue to rise and has the potential to become, sometime down the road, maybe half a generation, a generation down the road, to become a true international currency.
We're all more or less currency geeks over here, so let's talk about the IMF's special drawing rights, the SDR, and whether the yuan could get included into that elite club possibly sometime next year is what I've been hearing. If it does, what are the implications? Is it symbolic? Is it just one more step towards attaining reserve currency status, or does it go beyond that?
I think it will be accepted then as a reserve currency, as a savings currency, and therefore its acceptance around the world will significantly increase. From our perspective, I think we do support renminbi to become an SAR currency.
And as for your business in China, the economic slowdown, the credit issues that we are seeing in the shadow banking sector, a corporate debt overhang as well, the margin debt in the stock market, there are a number of risks in the China market. Does that block or does it blunt your expansion in the world's second largest economy?
No. If you look at OCBC's exposure in China, our portfolio is not representative of the Chinese economy. We are focusing on serving the Chinese companies in China, but also those companies who have the ability to invest outside of China. I'll just give you some statistics which I think are pretty revealing. If you look at our annual report at the end of June, we declare that our Greater China exposure is 57 billion Sing dollars. Then if you look at how much of our exposure is really booked in China, which therefore, for lack of a better term, I just call it China, it's only 7 billion. 50 billion of the 57 billion dollars that we have our exposure in Greater China is actually outside of China. They're in Hong Kong, they're in Singapore, they're in Malaysia, they're in Indonesia. So for those exposures which are really outside of China, it except for the linkages into China, because the investment originated from China, it has got no direct exposure to the Chinese economy. This is the way that we have been doing business in China, and this will continue to be the way that we want to expand our Greater China
business. So your portfolio is relatively sheltered and insulated from
proliferation. Unfortunately, it's because our exposure, we are not able to compete with the Chinese banks inside China. So we have always said, if you want to be in the market, you better find your competitive edge. We found out that our competitive edge in the China market is really outside of China. So to establish a relationship inside China, but to bank with them more outside of China, is what we wanted to do. And we have been doing that.
Excuse me. These markets and the economies, they get me choked up, which is why I'm like this. We've got a couple of minutes left, so I hope the organizers will indulge me. Why don't we take a few questions from the floor for Samuel? We have some colleagues in the audience who have mics. Is there anyone who has a question for Samuel Shin? Was there a gentleman here who had his hand up? No? Any questions for Samuel? It's not often that you have the OCBC CEO here. Not every day. All right, going once, going twice. Okay, let me just round things off with, we do have a question. Yes, sir. Alan, where are you from? Where are you from and who are you?
Alan Tan, Enterprise FinTech Innovation Publication based out of Hong Kong. Do you see the greater China market as being more of a significant business opportunities for OCBC over the next 4 or 5 years? And if so, how critical is technology in helping you drive that business forward?
Yes, I do think the Greater China market is going to be of increasing importance to OCBC. For the reason that if you look at across Asia, and for that matter, across the world, China has been the originator of many business and economic activities. And as Mr. Wee said earlier, the One Belt, One Road initiative is actually an important initiative in the sense that we will continue to see a lot of investments that these Chinese companies is going to make overseas. And from that respect, we are in countries, Indonesia, Malaysia in particular, which are resource-rich countries, which are the prime targets for the One Belt, One Road initiative to come. So it's going to create opportunities for us. As I said, if you wanted to bank with the Chinese companies overseas, you have to bank with them onshore to at least to know them. So we're able to expand the relationship there as well. The other development is people would know QDII2, where they will now open up their capital account and allow, under a controlled environment, from 6 cities initially to have a flow of money without going through the trade mechanism and without going through an approved project mechanism to be invested overseas. Again, that creates additional opportunities for us. So I do see that we will continue to expand in the Greater China region, and we will continue to see the proportion of revenue and earnings made from Greater China to rise.
I just wanted to follow up on that. Are there any opportunities that are derived from the Stock Connect, Hong Kong, Shanghai, and soon to be Hong Kong, Shenzhen as well? Number one. And number two, this December will mark the 25th year of the stock markets in China. Do you think at this point in time they have evolved to the stage where they should be functioning as fully fledged, developed markets and deeply penetrated markets and liquid markets? Because we're not seeing that right now. So two questions that I have.
I think the China stock market is not yet fully developed in terms of many areas, in terms of disclosure requirements, in terms of letting the private sector to direct the direction of the stock market. So it is still some time away that we can really say the China stock market is equivalent of a stock market, for example, in Singapore. With respect to Stock Connect, it is actually another way of opening up China's currency control, China's capital control. You see, the way that China has been opening up its currency is very different. People all talk about when is China going to be
have a freely convertible currency. I don't think to have their currency freely convertible is even on the Chinese leaders' mind. They don't need that. They don't necessarily want that. They don't want that because once you have a freely convertible currency, a lot of the things in the financial markets outside of China will go directly through the conversion of the ability to convert the currency back into China. They don't want that, they don't need that. However, this does not mean that they do not want the currency to be an international currency. But in order to create an international currency, but not a convertible currency, they have to let the currency flow cross-border through controlled mechanism, starting with trade, starting with QFII, starting with QDII, now we have QFII2, we have Stock Connect. All these are ways to allow the currency to become international, but short of becoming convertible.
If there aren't any more questions, I think I have to wrap up the proceedings there, otherwise I'll get scolded by the organisers for going over my allotted time. Any last burning questions? If not, then I shall bring this session to a close, and my thanks.
Thank you, Sri.
Samuel Shin.
Thank you very much, and thank you
for the opportunity to see all of you. Thank you very much. Thank Fascinating you. Conversation.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I'm sure we can continue after the session and over coffee. So thank you very much for joining us once again.
Good morning. I'll just do a quick introduction for myself and my fellow panelists. So welcome to SIBOR's ASEAN Leaders in Conversation. My name is Nam Soon once again, and I'm the managing partner for EY Financial Services in ASEAN. We're very privileged today to have with us a number of bankers from leading regional and global banks who are very active in ASEAN. So I'll take the opportunity to introduce them one by one. So on my left, extreme left, Lisa Robbins, who's the head of Global Transaction Banking in Asia Pacific, Deutsche Bank. Thomas Tan, who is the Group Head of Transaction Banking for CIMB Group. Kun Song Po, who has an equivalent role in Krung Thai Bank based in Thailand. So panelists, thank you for being here today with us. Let me begin by setting some context to the conversation. We heard earlier from Sam a little bit around the excitement around ASEAN integration. The ASEAN and the ASEAN Economic Community, the AEC, for those of you familiar with the initiative, is an excellent opportunity to create a single market that is potentially both integrated, a lot more integrated, and connected to the global marketplace. You know, the AEC is supposed to be a platform that would allow banks to get gain entrance into new markets and get acquire new customers. Equally, the benefits for the corporations and the institution and individuals to gain greater access to financial services, be it credit, wealth management, or insurance, to cater to the various infrastructure lending needs, as well as the rising mass consumer markets in the different populations across ASEAN. So it's all very exciting, but what's the catch? It's, again, for those who have been in the region or know of the region, be fair to say there's some amount of criticism in terms of the pace of the integration. So whilst it was relatively easy to get lower trade barriers, financial integration is a completely different ballgame. EY published a report about 2 to 3 months ago on the status of the AEC. It talks about some of the opportunities, but it also analyzes some of the challenges and key issues that need to be considered. For example, how do we put in place common regulatory standards, and how do we address market conduct practices that differ quite differently across ASEAN, the different ASEAN countries. There is this concept of the qualified ASEAN banks. who theoretically have a single passport to operate, rather their intent is rather seamlessly across the region. But what is the governance around it? What's the supervision around that? Who should be supervising this? Who sets the rules? And of course, there's the HO debate about who's going to win, the locals, the domestics, the large regionals versus the international banks. And so I'm quite happy to have a very mixed group of bankers to, I'm sure they offer very different perspectives. Then there's also the question around capital, which we all know is very important in terms of freedom of capital move across borders. And whilst this is not necessarily contingent on the AEC being successful, because a lot of the capital is already relatively free to move, but the opportunities to improve that, issues to consider around where capital may be raised and where investors may be investing. Now, removing some of the barriers towards capital inflow and outflows is quite important, but we are operating in a very diverse marketplace, and so we have a much more mature financial market like Singapore, and then you get to some of the countries which are potentially a lot less mature in North ASEAN. So how do we prevent systemic risk from happening? So all of this has been done progressively and over time frame. So I think, whilst there's a lot of opportunities, clearly there are some challenges. And so I think the objective of today's panel is really to ask our panelists, given that the ASEAN business is very much front and center on your minds, what are some of the opportunities and what do they see are some of the challenges? So perhaps I would begin by posing a first question to Lisa, if that's all right.
Sure.
In terms of, all this talk about ASEAN financial integration, how important is it to in your mind?
I think to me it's not a if question, it's a necessity. Consider this: ASEAN together is the seventh largest GDP in the world. In Asia, it consolidated; it's the third largest. We anticipate continued 5% growth, double the number of households, 163 million households will be entering the middle class. Together, ASEAN is much bigger than the independent parts. And therefore, the ASEAN should be front and center. It is a much bigger voice together than separate. So I don't think it's a question of should it exist. It's a question of how it can exist effectively and to use that voice.
Maybe I can get Thomas's view on this as well.
Yeah, I agree with what Lisa said, and I think you mentioned some of it. From my perspective, it's the promise, right? It's the promise, it's the hope that this greater integration will lead towards greater economic activity, greater prosperity for all. So I think there's no doubt about that. And I think, if you look at it, there's already a lot of companies, CIMB being one of them, who are, fully committed and who are already pursuing this ASEAN integrated dream, hope. But for those of us who are at the front line, it is also a very challenging, it's also a very frustrating activity, because it is not integrated yet. It is not fully harmonized yet. For those of us who are at the forefront, we have to maneuver through the minefield, as it may, for this hope to be realized.
That's very good. So I think we'll get into some of the challenges in a bit more detail later on. But just to wrap up, Khun Somphol, what do you feel ASEAN integration is important? And given Thailand plays quite an important role in terms of where you are positioned in North Asia, North ASEAN.
I think in general, when we look at AEC, it started more than 30 years ago. And there has three contexts: the ASEAN economic community, the ASEAN securities, and also culturals. So at that time, a lot of countries are developing in the slow pace, and a lot of contribution collaboration need to be done. If you look back from that time until now, there are a lot of interaction between countries like Thailand, Myanmar, Laos, Cambodia, Singapore, everywhere. You see a lot of businessmen going around and do their own business. I think in terms of integration of ASEAN, it's basically ASEAN cannot stand alone. We have to work with other countries like Japan, China, Korea. So it would create the whole belt of interaction amongst the world economy. So I think together, ASEAN can be part of intra-ASEAN, and it can be a connection to the rest of the world. So I think in that context, ASEAN integration has started long time ago. However, the interaction on that, in order to make it happen much better, we need a lot more collaboration, including government, including a lot of stakeholders, and that would make it happen.
Thank you. I think that's a very good point you made, and it's a nice segue to the next question around collaboration, given that there are a number of stakeholders in this space, the bankers, yourselves, the corporations, your clients that you serve, as well as policymakers and regulators. So the question really maybe I can pose, Thomas, on this one is, you know, should it be market-driven? Should it be driven by the policymakers, the regulators? What's your view on that?
Yeah. So if I look at the history and what Khun Somphol said, the original drive was obviously by the governments. I think, you know, the vision set up by the founding fathers of ASEAN exactly meant that. If you look at, you know, in terms of integrating ASEAN, what are the benefits, you know, and also to, you know, integrate it in terms of culture, etc., right? But I think, you know, what has happened, if you look at it today, I think, you know, the market has gone ahead of it. So if you look at the companies that have started moving, you know, across ASEAN to take, you know, to get the benefit of you know the markets, the common markets, right? They have moved ahead because the regulations or the harmonization has happened slower. So, you know, up to today, the companies that benefit from moving across border, and you have many examples of that. So, if you look at in banking, CIMB is one of those banks that have seen the opportunity and move ahead to build up significant presence within ASEAN. If you look at another good example of that would be in the aviation industry, AirAsia, who has moved on ahead, and I'm sure they face, you know, similar to us, a lot of challenges when, you know, dealing with multiple regulators in all the different jurisdictions. But I guess, you know, the opportunity outweighs the cost, and they have moved ahead. If you look at the automotive industry, right, you see also, you know, a lot more integration across ASEAN, despite, you know, the harmonization is yet to come in. But, you know, and I take some post point as well, it would have been easier for all of us to operate had, you know, if the regulators and if the governments come in and assist in the, you know, faster pace of integration, faster pace of harmonization of the rules and the regulation.
I think you gave some very good examples in your organization, as it has been quite aggressively, even a long time, some time back, positioning itself across ASEAN, and you mentioned a number of other Malaysian companies, so that's quite relevant. Khun Somphol, if I may ask you, do you agree with that, or do you have a different take on this?
I think in general, when we look at the overall context and we together comparing the public side or the government side, the public side has started long time ago. I remember people import products and export products. That happened more than 100 years. However, there are a lot of regulations that protecting import and export from each country. And however, and as well, when we look at the context of the ASEAN, the AEC, it's not only goods or products. It includes people in transit, resources. Country like us in Thailand, we have less than 1% unemployment rates, which means that we need a lot more human resource. There are a lot more people who interact and work in each of the industries. So I think the government side would able to enabling the better efficiencies, and as well to able to reach the common goal of improving the overall 10 countries in ASEAN. I think that's where the context of the AAC started long time ago, to enable each country to be able to work together at the same level. So I think that's how the market is going to be open.
Yes. Yeah. This sounds like there's a couple of views here that the market's doing its own thing anyway, irregardless, and it's, you know, the policymakers probably need to move a bit quicker to catch up with, you know, what's required. Your view?
I look at it and I think about the importance of private-public partnership, and that it's not an either-or situation. We require in any of the markets, I think, of strong cooperation between both the regulators and the private sector, including all of us as institutions working closely to develop what we think are rules and regulations that are implementable and that will drive the goals of ASEAN, and we see that happening. I would just like to add something. Listening and also thinking about this region, I think about the constant kind of yin and yang between the goals of unification and harmonization, which are so important in encouraging more standards and guidelines to encourage everything that my co-panelists have said, whether it's to foster employment, to foster financial inclusion, to foster a whole host of things. On the other hand, we're seeing other things because in the region, countries are operating perhaps at different stages. And so in some cases, we see some forms of fragmentation, some protectionism, capital being a little more fragmented, and a whole host of things, to your point about movement of talent and the ability to move freely and to encourage development of talent and bench strength in some areas, we see some restrictions being imposed. So I think this is not going to be a very linear progression from here to there. All of the countries are operating at different levels, and I think we have to take that into account as we consider the promise that ASEAN offers.
That's a good point. If I can stay with you, Lisa, you know, this whole competition between the global banks and the large regionals or the large domestic players, who do you think is going to win in this space?
I would reframe your question. So while this whole thing about the competition, actually, I think one of the wonderful things about being different is that we complement each other. So I think the global banks have access to markets perhaps that are not within the purview of either one of my panelists here. And so we can help to position ASEAN and bring opportunity into the market. We can also share our experiences elsewhere. So I view it more as a symbiotic relationship. Krung Thai and both banks have a strong presence in the region. They have, in Thailand, you have a very strong position. In Malaysia and the region, you are expanding, and we can work together. I don't really view this as a, you know, you win and I lose. I really do, and I know it may sound very trite, but I think we win together. This is not a either-or situation.
Sure. I think it's the world we live in anyway, right?
It is the world. And at times, I mean, this is just banking.
Yeah.
We are friend, we're foe. But I think in the case of the ASEAN, we're working very closely together. We have a common aim.
Yeah, maybe I think just to try to get an answer out, you know, it's Khun Songpo, do you think clearly? I think there are areas where the banks will compete, the domestics and the areas where you collaborate. What do you think are some of this differentiating competitive advantage that, you know, say Krung Thai might have or any of the Thai banks might have against an international player?
I think in general it comes back to the consumer, the customers. If the model that we are working on is not going to be able to answer our customers' need, we out. So when we look at customer, I think we have to also look at them. If they are locals, they are MNCs, how big are they, who are they interact with, and what chain are they in? And along those, it would answer what kind of business model or strategy that we have to take place. When we have our customer domestically, they can be our main customers, while some of the banks may say, that customer, they're not that interested. A lot of people in each country do commute. A lot of business has expanded. There is no way that we can have our branch everywhere in each country. So we have to partner with the bank that has branch in that country to do what? To help customer to success. So I think it's all come back to the customers and the consumer.
That's a pretty good point, Thomas.
I'll add to that. I mean, I think each, like what Lisa and both my colleagues here said, you know, we all have our own different segments. So I would say that the multinational corporation, they would typically deal with the international banks, and the international banks would be their gateway. And in some of those situations, we would be collaborating as local banks with the international banks to serve that segment. But if you think through the other segment, so if you move down to the mid-corp, and then you move down to the SME, so because increasingly, let's say, you know, you are seeing a lot of top-tier corporates from either Indonesia or Thailand, you know, moving their production or moving their activity to another ASEAN country. In that situation, then, you know, their primary banker in their home market could be either Krung Thai Bank, right? And then they will, you know, when they move to Malaysia, for example, right? So I could partner with him here and serve the client, right? But if you think of one more complication, as we move down the chain, you're talking about SMEs now. They are increasingly also following the supply chain and moving cross-border. Who's going to bring those guys? So, and that's where our model of being the full-service bank, we try, you know, to help in that regard. So it's not easy to onboard, bring across an SME from one country to another, even though they are our own company. So, you know, if my SME client in Malaysia wants to go to Thailand, it's a big challenge. But I would say that it's easier for us to do that, and that's what we are trying to facilitate. And I would say that also that as you move down the tier, you know, that's where the help is really required, because for a multinational or a top-tier client, if they want to move across border, you know, they have bankers, they have lawyers, they have, you know, a lot of resources. Right, but if you're an SME, you are probably more reliant on one partner to be able to facilitate that.
Sure. Yeah. So I think at the end of the day, it's all being very practical and understanding what the customer needs are, getting the segmentation right. You know, Thomas, you know, early on you talked about the market moving ahead of policymakers. I'd like to come back to just dive into that a little bit deeper. What do you think? You know, what would bankers like to see in terms of accelerating the financial integration? Can you give a bit more specifics around that?
I mean, I can look at it on a few perspectives. Let's say if I just look at it from the bank perspective, and, you know, talking very specific to my bank, we are operating in, you know, five or six jurisdictions in ASEAN, we would like to see definitely, one rule, right? So it's easier for us, you know, when we come up against the regulator. Obviously, that's a big ask. It's not going to happen anytime soon, you know, but that is the hope, right? So it'd be easier for us to operate. And I think there are a lot of other basic things like freer movement of people. So, you know, if you mentioned about the status of having a qualified ASEAN bank, you know, so if we qualify as an ASEAN bank, hopefully, you know, we can, you know, and we are recognized as an ASEAN bank, the ASEAN governments will allow us freer movement of our people, or very basic things like, let's say, where we locate our data centers, right? You know, that will help in terms of managing a lot of the IT costs. So examples of that. But on the wider note, if you look at, let's say, on the financial services, you know, there are a lot more work required in terms of to address the on the issuer side as well as on the investor side. So on the issuer side, you know, to allow ASEAN corporates freer movement, you know, to go and issue in the other ASEAN capital markets, because, you know, ASEAN as a investor pool, our savings rates are very high, and, you know, we collectively the more advanced ASEAN nations are, you know, are big potential investors, right, or for direct investment. But unfortunately, a lot of that is invested into U.S. treasuries and into the G3 countries instead of recycling into ASEAN. So we would like to see a lot more harmonization of the rules to allow, you know, issuers from the, the more emerging ASEAN countries to be able to issue in the more advanced ASEAN markets. And also the other part is on the investor side. So again, all the way down to investors. So, you know, the concept about, let's say, ASEAN passporting, right? So at the moment, the three countries have gone ahead, Malaysia, Singapore, and Thailand. So that's a good move. Unfortunately, you know, it has not taken off as much as the industry would like. So that's another example of the challenges, right? Mm. So the vision is there, and I think, you know, the platform has been set. It's
the execution and the pace of execution.
The pace of the execution, yep. Because that's where, you know, a lot of the nitty-gritty comes in, and the approval is required from each regulator. But the concept is good.
Sure. Lisa?
Well, I agree with what Thomas has just said. We are very interested in seeing that we move from idea to framework to a set of rules and regulations that are actually executable. And when you think about the region, there are a lot of differences that exist, including difference in legal frameworks, which drive dispute resolution, reciprocity, a whole host of issues. That being said, when I look at our customer base, we're seeing tremendous enthusiasm for investments in the region, not necessarily yet taking advantage of the ASEAN, but taking advantage of the promise and opportunity there now. As we see the Asia passporting, the ASEAN post-trade settlement link becoming more than agreements on paper and moving into execution, we envision a lot more interest that will turn into actual reality, particularly when you consider that the household incomes are going to increase significantly, need for opportunities for investment will increase. We just need to make it a reality. And I think part of that has to do with working closely together with the regulators to change it from a framework that exists on a piece of paper into something that's practical. And we have to deal with some of the unsaid things, which are the barriers to entry. On the flip side, on the trade and cash side, I think some very exciting things have happened this year with the Cebu Agreement, the CAP agreement that came out in earlier in the spring, which offers very key guidelines to the areas in which the ASEAN will focus in order to make financial inclusion, but not just financial inclusion, supply chains more accessible, more fluid, and easier to take advantage of. So I think there's a lot going on. And while I know that you mentioned that this has been in the works for several decades, I think that the reality is that if it's this decade or this century where it's really taken off. And perhaps there are many reasons why the takeoff is here focus on the ASEAN has become it's kind of in the headlights, more in the limelight, possibly because of a balancing within Asia, a whole host of reasons, but I think that gives, the opportunity is now, and I think we're all trying to take advantage of it.
Yeah. Khun Somphol, do you also think the opportunity is now?
I think if, to add on Lisa, that why it's been working a decade, and it's now happening. I think it's happening now that is much more on the timing, where in the past, if you look back 20 years ago, most of the countries, in the crisis year, a lot of countries still have a lot of similarities. Products that have been produced from one country to another countries are quite the same. However, at this stage, a number of countries has decided what do they want to do. What are they going to focus on? And it doesn't mean that every country would do the same. So the collaboration, the focus,
collaboration and the platform are now going to come and work together. Mm-hmm. I think that that would make a lot more sense in terms of the collaboration amongst the ASEAN countries. So I think that that is going to happen. And that another thing is that we see a lot of change of the nature of the trades. In the past, we have a lot of LCs, but now LCs is very small. We have less than 20%. A number of payments has changed. Technology also changed. Mm. I think together with the collaboration and the readiness of whatever is available in the market now, I think it makes things a lot easier and a lot cheaper.
Very good, very good. Let's switch gears a little bit and focus on the question on, you know, what's really important for your businesses, your customers. So the question is, for your mid-size and corporate clients, you know, what is their level of appetite in terms of what do they see is in the ASEAN opportunity? Are they excited as you are by what's happening with integration?
I'm happy to take that. I think our customers are not. Our customers are generally large MNCs and investors, and this is an opportunity for us to help position the ASEAN as a region. Many of our customers are still looking at individual countries. I mean, the truth be told, they still look at Indonesia, they still look at Singapore, they look at Malaysia and Thailand. Thailand for supply chain. You know, if you can divvy up just as you said. And we're seeing our customers, however, start looking at it as we talk to them and as other, as ASEAN becomes a brand, if you will. That ASEAN is being looked at as a critical mass with opportunity. Our the growth in demographics, the commodity, the manufacturing, the opportunity to expand in the marketplace to help with the huge amount of infrastructure build that is planned for in this region all make it a very, very interesting opportunity. But we still have a ways to go, I think, before it's really looked at as a transferable opportunity. And what I mean transferable is I go to Indonesia, I can easily go to Thailand or somewhere else within the region. And I think we still have a ways to go before that happens. But the promise is there. Our investor base is the second client segment that we are very focused on, and we're seeing huge increases in assets under management coming into the region. Is that sustainable? We'll see. But I think the programs that are underway and the regulatory environment will help encourage more and more interest in the region.
Thomas, your
question? No, I think the answer is definitely yes. If you look at it from a few fronts, you know, the intra-ASEAN trade flows, you know, is the fastest growing globally. Right. Although it's still a very small component of the entire ASEAN trade, but the trading within ASEAN has been growing at double-digit pace and is continuing to grow very well. So that indicates that, you know, that you know the activity is there. And if you look at it post the financial crisis especially, as the global market slowed down, that, you know, that the ASEAN intra-ASEAN trade grew even more. Because, you know, then they look at the closer markets, right? And you think intuitively, you know, it's a slam dunk, right? Because it's so much easier to sell next door than to sell, you know, far away. And plus, you know, the logistic advantages, right? So, you know, there's no doubt about that. But the other thing that you're starting to see increasingly also is the foreign direct investment. Mm. Meaning, you know, as you see, ASEAN corporates moving either their, so one is moving their, into to take advantage of the markets, right? And as ASEAN markets improve, as the middle class grow in ASEAN, right? It's as ASEAN as a consumption base increase, right? So a lot of the ASEAN corporates are looking to sell within ASEAN to take advantage of that higher wealth and that higher demand. The other part is to take advantage of ASEAN as a production hub. So, you know, they are moving production activities within ASEAN. So a lot of that, for example, led, you know, either by China or Thailand into the Mekong Valley, right? Into the Mekong Delta area into lower cost production countries to take advantage of production. So you see, definitely you will see that in some of the emerging ASEAN countries, the ASEAN FDI, so there's a huge Thai Malaysian investment community into Cambodia, for example, or Thai into Laos, right? So they are the biggest FDI moving into this country. So that trend, I think, will accelerate, as the rules and the rules come down.
Yeah, that's quite interesting, because that extended Mekong or area, market area, is it's a natural extension almost of the Thai market. Your views, Khun Song?
I actually personally think a bit different. I think it's an opportunity. However, it's also a risk. When we look at the economic cycle during the past 20 years, I feel it's a lot shorter than the past. And a lot of people think about ASEAN, a lot of population, a lot of young population that is growing up. And may I ask if we think ASEAN as what? Consumer? Manufacturing? Or resource? Some of the country, they have their own development at different stage, as Lisa mentioned. Some of the country that some of our customers really excited and wanted to go there, and they thought that they should have make some money within a short period, but instead it take a lot longer. Mm-hmm. However, I think on that context, I think we have to look at what do we really think about ASEAN, and what our customers are thinking about it. If that country is already ready for that yet. That is one side. Another thing is also, I think the speed of change is so quick. And when we look at the change of the ASEAN, definitely people in transit, it has moved around. The money making from the business that they target in each of the industries are different. Look back 4 years ago in Thailand, we have a number of problems in our countries, a number of supporting initiatives has been implemented. Auto industry has been doing a lot better. The chain tier 1 and tier 2, they make parts and they have to make it 24 hours. And suddenly the whole things change. It's slow down. Instead of 24 hours, they make only about 8 to 12 hours. So things change so quick. And I think in this ASEAN integration, when we want to be part of the ASEAN integration, appetite definitely there when we see the opportunity. But we have to check if it is a real opportunity in details in each of the industries.
So I would like to add to that. So I would say that from the point of view of, if you look at risk, I understand investing is always risky, right? But my proposition is this, right? If you're going to invest, where would you invest? Would you invest nearby, somewhere nearby, within a two-hour flight time, where you can fly in, in a lot of the ASEAN countries, you can do a day trip, right? Versus, investing in a further out place like China, or if you think about some of the opportunities in Africa or in Latin America. Right, so I think in terms of being able to manage the business, in terms of doing the due diligence, I always think of it this way, right? Where you can just take a flight and go there, right? It's a lot easier for you to control that business. It's a lot easier for you to go and manage that business, right? So I think that's the advantage, and I think a lot of companies have already starting to do that. Right, and I always, before this job, I was in the market side, and I always say that, unfortunately, on the markets business, right, if you think of it on the same perspective, right, if I were to buy either a fixed income instrument, if I'm a Malaysian investor, to buy a fixed income instrument, denominated in Thai baht or Indonesian rupiah, You know, the same principle should apply, right? If I want to do the due diligence in terms of understanding the product, it's a lot easier for me to understand that than to understand U.S. Treasuries, right? Yeah, I have to go and in terms of due diligence and how far the market is, right? But unfortunately, in that instance, you know, the same doesn't apply, you know, and it's because of some of the rules and the harmonization is not quite there yet.
Sure.
But I'm saying,
sure.
To come back to the point, I would argue that, you know, to invest, it's a lot nearer, a lot easier for you to manage than, you know, some of the further away countries.
Lisa, you're
but
smiling,
a lot of
I'm
further
sure.
away countries are investing here. So if you think about it, ASEAN has surpassed China in terms of FDI. So ASEAN is a very interesting opportunity, not just for intra-ASEAN, but as well for ASEAN countries coming in. I would argue that you invest in places where you understand the governance, the transparency, and you have all the things that we discussed earlier, access to resources, whether it's talent or other types of resources. So I agree with you in part, but not entirely.
And I think that's why, Lisa, I always enjoy conversations like this, because, you know, it's always different perspectives depending on where you operate and
that's right.
where you come from. I like to kind of take the discussion into, you know, in the second part of our panel, and this is really around maybe questions more targeted for your business. So if I may come back to you, Khun Song Po, you know, you mentioned earlier the pace of change. And one of the areas I think we all know which is changing in your part of the market in North ASEAN is, you know, Thailand traditionally has been the hub, but there are, you know, companies that are looking, already in the process of moving some of their, whether it's manufacturing or other sorts of operations into some of the lower cost CLMV countries. How do you see Thai banks respond to that threat? And, you know, what's your bank doing in response to that?
I think in general, as I mentioned earlier, there is no one country that can do everything. Then we have to work together with our neighboring countries. And we have to focus on what we can do at best, and we can connect with the rest. For us, I definitely, a number of interactions between Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, and Myanmar has been working a long way. A number of Thai companies expand their manufacturing into Laos and Cambodia. A lot of construction materials has been shipped from Thailand to Myanmar and Laos and Cambodia. And as I mentioned earlier, we don't have enough resource. We have very little number of population, even though we have a good number of population, but unemployment rate is still too low. If we add on Laos and Cambodia together, still not enough. So at the end, we have to do upgrading in terms of the technologies and the capital stocks too. As a Thai bank, we are part of the supporting to the whole chain, not only in Thailand, but including the upper ASEAN countries as well. So we try to understand what would be the things that we need to do in the next 3 to 5 years. And we support those. That's where the appetite come in. And because of the development of the capital markets as well, I think a lot of fundraising in the debt capital market has been very active in Thailand and Laos and in Cambodia too. A number of issuance from Laos has been issued in Thailand for the investors as well. So I think as a Thai bank, what we want to do, we want to improve our own capability. We want to improve our own products and also service to our Thai customers, including the one that wants to do business overseas. We have branch in Laos and Cambodia. We have representative in Myanmar. But if all those our customer wants to work with other countries, then we have to work with other banks too. So I think generally the expansion in upper ASEAN is there. And because we consider ourselves as the whole chain of manufacturing and services, I always use this example. If you look at your Mentos candy, the candy is made in Vietnam, and the candy is packed in Thailand, and it's shipped and sell in Hong Kong and Singapore. So it's no longer one country that do everything. So I think it's come back to the collaboration that we have to do together.
Yeah, so it sounds like you're adapting to that change as well.
Just one last thing that I think is good things is, I personally feel that every country has tried to improve their own efficiencies. The cost of logistics and the cost of operation has been lower across ASEAN, not only Thailand, Singapore, but everywhere in ASEAN. In particular, in our country, we also try to put on our capital stock. We keep building our road, mass transit, in order to ensure that the logistic cost is not too high. So I think that is the way that we would see a lot of improvement in ASEAN as well.
Sure. I think we all agree that lowering the cost to serve is very important, part of a successful business, and technology has a big role to play in that, particularly with the advent of new technologies these days. So I Lisa, I know this is a topic that's quite dear to your heart. The question is, what's your view in terms of how can technology assist with the integration in ASEAN?
Well, I think just going back to the goals of the most recent CAP agreement, the CEBU agreement, where it stated that, financial inclusion, management of the supply chain, and trade facilitation were key aspects of that agreement. And so if you go back and you say, so what does that actually mean? How does it move from a piece of paper and a signed agreement into practice? There's a long distance between the two. And I think we as actually financial institutions and fintech companies can really help with that. So there are a number of areas. First, supply chain finance, where we can help with that. Second is around the development of, as you pointed out, Thomas, logistics opportunities. If you think and infrastructure, when you think about what just Indonesia and all the different islands and how they connect, how giving people ability to make payments and cash are quite challenging. So opportunities around cashless payments, opportunities around supply chain. And finally, the ability to facilitate e-commerce, whether it's through BPO or other activities. Of course, I don't think we can get through any session at Cybos without mentioning blockchain. I don't know what blockchain will mean yet for the future, but perhaps eventually even more technologies like blockchain can help make the connection simpler. But I think that's a little bit in the future. What we can do today is work with the products and services that we know we are developing to help make that, to facilitate that supply chain, the supply chain that cuts across Myanmar, Thailand.
All of that,
and beginning to end, and I think that's something that we can be very helpful with.
Sure, and Thomas, CIMB is, we know, is a big adopter of technology. Your views on this?
Yes, definitely, right? I think there are many examples of technology being used. Lisa mentioned BPO. I think BPO has a lot of advantages in ASEAN because ASEAN, your shipping times are so short, right? So typical shipping time is 2 days. In some instances, is within 1 day the goods arrive, right? So your traditional way of settling and clearing is going to have its disadvantage. So I think BPO will have a strong opportunity to improve trade within ASEAN. Another example of technology is in ASEAN there is a high incidence of migrant workers, migrant labor, and it's happened for a long time. Yeah. So for those migrant workers who work cross-border, there are a lot of Indonesians working in Malaysia, a lot of Filipinos, and so they need to repatriate, right? And traditionally, they can go through the unbanked, right? So the hawala system and et cetera, right? But you see that, as we progress, we have used technology, and today, we have a remittance system, and these are, not your traditional via SWIFT, but you have a lot of banks like ourselves who have our own proprietary system to do the remittance, and the remittance for this business is done at a fraction of the cost because you know you're dealing with the migrant workers. So that is to me that's an example of technology being used, and it's been used for a long time. You know, some of this system, we built ours 5 years ago, and there are some banks who have built them even earlier. So proprietary system to do migrant worker remittance, right? That is a good use of technology, and I don't think it's anything new. It's you know, an early form of blockchain or Ripple type of technology that's being used already.
And actually, because of the nature of the problems in this region, it offers a great opportunity to be a laboratory to develop new products. So when you think about the financial inclusion challenge, going to mobile payments, going to the services that you have, there are a whole host of things that I think can help leapfrog, and lots of legacy systems haven't yet been built. So.
Yeah, and
good news.
You know, I'm just picking up the point around unbanked and also getting using technology potentially to access markets where it may be difficult to set up a branch or in remote areas. Kun Songpo, given that some of the countries are similar, maybe difficult to get to the customers, do you see a role for technology in that space?
Definitely. I think the technology help us connect. And then I think we have to figure out how we want to connect. In each of countries, they have entities, and they may do it differently. I think bank, non-bank, domestic, local, and international bank. At the end, we have to find a way to connect. I personally believe if we want to work alone, we out. But if we want to work together and put customer as the person that we want to answer their needs, the model would come.
So I'm just looking at the time. I think we've got a little bit more than 5 minutes left. So yeah, just to summarize and perhaps recap a little bit of the discussions. I think we acknowledge that, you know, don't get me wrong, I think there's plenty of opportunities. Equally, there are a number of things what we're hearing from the panelists would be nice if you know policymakers were, you know, stepping up with what's happening in the marketplace. For me, it's interesting to hear the different perspectives, from Lisa, from Thomas, from Kun Songpo. Just depending on where the branch is, or rather where the bank, where your organizations are strong in and where your customers are. I think we spent some time talking about the importance of segmenting the customers and lowering the cost to serve. And of course, technology in all of that, as a key enabling tool. But also what's currently available and what perhaps is more distant, right? So execution, I think to borrow your point, Thomas, execution is quite key and the pace of execution. At this point, I'd like to open up to the floor and to the audience and see if there are any questions for our panelists.
Very clear.
Nope, it's quiet. Yeah, it's all good. No challenging questions at all? Okay, if not, then I would like to thank the panelists and the audience for listening in. Could you just join me in giving a warm kind of thank you for participating? Thank you. And thank you for your patience. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Thanks.